architect Divya Chakravarti. She completed her undergraduate studies from SRM University and she went on to pursue her master's in historic preservation and urbanism and study of the built environment from the University of California, Los Angeles. She went on to work for the Department of Planning and Preservation for the city of Pasadena, California. She also did a brief stint of work for Historic Scotland, Edinburgh, UK. She also worked on conservation projects like Khalsa Mahal, Gokhale Hall in Chennai and Marimalapa Educational Trust in Mysore. She is currently working as a director of Samrakshan Heritage Consultancy. She is also a co-founder of the Artisan Reprisal of Traditional Materials, Method and Technology. She goes on to conduct workshops to revive traditional and lost methods of construction.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series for Bachelors of Architecture. The subject we are discussing is environmental science. The topic we'll be delving into is environment, ecosystems, and biodiversity. In this lecture, we'll be looking into biodiversity, the different types of hotspots across the globe and especially in our country, endangered species, and the importance of biodiversity. Now, if you look at the different types of biodiversity, species diversity is very crucial. It actually defines as a variety of different species of living forms in a given area. India has around 2 crore species of the total species described. The species diversity peaks in the tropical forest as well as in the coral reefs. Then you have the genetic diversity. This is defined as the variation at the level of individual genes or the heritable variation within and between population of organisms. The more genetic diversity in a population, the more chances in variation. These variations actually help the individuals to have a variant that help it to suit for a new environment. So, more variations are available, it's possible for that organism or that creature to thrive better in different conditions because they can get different variety from different gene pools. Ecosystem or habitat diversity. Ecosystem is the structural and functional unit of the biosphere. So, ecosystem diversity is defined as the aggregation of various habitats, community types, and abiotic environment in a given area. India has one of the richest ecosystem diversity, ranging from deserts, plains, hills, mangroves, rainforests to the very cold Himalayas. So, if you look at the distribution of biodiversity here, you have flora and fauna diversity depends on climate, altitude, that is the elevation from sea level, soils, presence of other species, so the species could have an interaction with them. Most of the biodiversity is concentrated in the tropical region. So, you have biodiversity hotspots. A region with high biodiversity with most of the species being endemic. India has 2 major biodiversity hotspots, Eastern Himalayan region and the Western Ghats. Now, if you look into the hotspots of biodiversity, hotspots are the main areas of focus for diversity conservation. These are the areas that are extremely rich in biodiversity. They have high level of endemism and are under constant threat of species extinctions and habitat destruction. Areas which exhibit high species richness as well as high species endemism are termed as hotspots of biodiversity. These hotspots covering less than 2% of the world's land area is found to have about 50% of the terrestrial biodiversity. So, these are the hotspots that you see. You can see there is a concentration in the tropical belt because their climate is more favorable, the kind of flora and fauna found there is more favorable. You have the China, northeastern part of Asia that's got a good belt, then very parts of Africa, then again South America and Central America gets the next region of hotspots. Now, we look at the list of hotspots that listed out in the world. This is actually very important because most of the biodiversity that's recorded in our world is from these hotspots. It's not actually possible to study every nook and corner of the world, though there are, it is pretty much considered that with the recent satellites and all of this that's happening, it's no part of the earth is considered unexplored. But to actually, for all practical purposes, when you're discussing different types of species of plants and animals where the study has to be done much more closely, there are a lot of areas that are unexplored and unidentified species are still there, and everyday new species are getting discovered. So, some of the hotspots here we have are tropical Andes, Mesoamerica, Caribbean, Brazil's Atlantic Forest, the Western Ecuador, Brazil's Cerrado, Central Chile, California Floristic Province, Madagascar, Eastern Arc and Coastal Forests of Tanzania, Western African Forests, Cape Floristic Province, Succulent Karoo, and again here in the eastern side as you come, you have the Mediterranean Basin, Caucasus, Sundaland, Wallacea, Philippines, Indo-Burma, South Central China, Western Nats or Sri Lanka, Southwest Australia, New Caledonia, New Zealand and Polynesia or Micronesia. So, you can see we actually occupy one of the hotspots of the world because like we discussed, it's mostly the tropical areas. This term was actually introduced, that is hotspots was introduced by Norman Myers in 88. Myers and later wrote about this in 2000 and he recognized 25 such hotspots in the world. These are on a global level at which two are present in India. The ones we will be discussing are Eastern Himalayas and the Western Ghats. According to Myers in this 2000 revelation, an area is designated as a hotspot when it contains at least 0.5% of the plant species as endemics. The Indian hotspots are not only rich in floral wealth and endemic species of plants, but also reptiles, amphibians, swallow-tailed butterflies and some mammals as well. Nearly 70% of the bird species in this hotspot is endemic. There are areas of high diversity, endemism and are also threatened by human activities. About 40% of terrestrial plants and 25% of vertebrate species are endemic and found in these hotspots. The 25 hotspots contain 44% of all vascular plant species, 35% of terrestrial vertebrates and encompass only 1.4% of the earth's surface. So, you can see what a small percentage of area we are actually talking about. All of this calculation becomes very important when we are talking about threats to biodiversity and conservation of biodiversity. However, collectively they have lost 88% of their original primary vegetation. Species in these areas are at risk from extinction if further habitat loss occurs. It has been estimated that about 50,000 endemic plants, which comprise 20% of global plant life, probably occur only in 18 hotspots in the world. Countries which have a relatively large proportion of this biodiversity hotspots are referred to as mega diversity nations, like we saw China, Central America and parts of South America. Moving on to the hotspots in our country, we have the Eastern Himalayas and the Western Ghats. These areas are particularly rich in floral wealth and endemism not only in the flowering plants, but also in reptiles, amphibians, butterflies and even few mammals. If you look at the Eastern Himalaya, we are talking about the border between China as well as India. And you have the area that comprises Nepal, Bhutan and neighboring states of northern India, along with a continuous sector of the Yunnan province in the southwest China. All Himalayan forests lie north of the Tropic of Cancer. And some of them are at altitudes of 1780 to 3500 meters and these can also be considered as tropical forests. Many deep and semi-isolated valleys are exceptionally rich in endemic plant species. In Sikkim, in an area of about 7000 kilometers square of 4,250 plant species, nearly 60% are endemic. Again, in Nepal, you have 7,000 plant species, many of which overlap with those of India, Bhutan, and even Yunnan. Of these, nearly 500 are believed to be endemic, endemic especially with respect to Nepal. Bhutan possesses an estimated 5,000, of which as many as 15% is considered to be endemic to that of the eastern Himalayas. Now, moving on to the Western Ghats, if you look at the map, this is the area we are discussing about, and even parts of Sri Lanka as well, because the type of weather conditions that is here continues on over there. So, we will discuss about the Western Ghats. Out of nearly 49,000 plant species, 1600 endemic, that is 40%, are found in 17,000 square kilometers along the seaside of Western Ghats along Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala, and even parts of Tamil Nadu. Forest tracts up to 500 in elevation, comprising which is about 1/5 of the entire forest expanse, are mostly evergreen, with those in the 500 to 1500 meter range, and these are considered semi-evergreen. Then you have two main centers of diversity, the Agastya Malay Hills and the Silent Valley, which is the reserve basin. The forest cover in the Western Ghats has reduced from 34% from 1972 to 89 in that period. The floral and faunal commonality of India's two hotspots. Although the two areas, the Eastern Himalayas and the Western Ghats, are today disjunct and have their own characteristic flora and fauna, there are a number of species common to both. Common floral species include Japonica, Rhododendron, Hyporicum, Hookerium, Lunaricera, Ligustrina, Gaultheria, and Symplocus lauriana. So, among all these kinds of fauna that are prevalent, you have the Himalayan and the Nilgiri tar, which is a kind of a deer, the Nilgiri pine marten, the laughing thrush associated with the plant genus Rubus, the great pied hornbill, the frog mouth, the fairy blue bird, lizard hawks, and the Rudolph bellied eagle. These are all found in both the regions. So, in spite of them being so vastly spaced and so diverse in terms of climate and other factors, geographical factors, there is a lot of common species you find within this belt. So, the 10 biogeography regions of India, you have the Trans-Himalayan, the orange belt you see here is the Himalayan, then you have the Indian desert over here, right here on top, then you have the semi-arid zone just below the desert, and then the thriving Western Ghats, which we discussed as the hotspot now, then the largest Deccan Peninsula, then you have the Gangetic Plain, again a very thriving, fertile piece of land. Northeastern India again is very good for its biodiversity, the islands of Andaman and Nicobar, and then finally the coast along the east. Even though it's not as diverse as the Western Ghats because of the lack of the mountain region, the coast also offers a very good combination of biodiversity. Endemic species, these are species that are found only in a particular geographical region because of its isolation, soil, and climatic conditions. So, these species are considered very important because if these species are removed from there and kept in another area, I'm not talking about zoos and things like that, but if they are tried to be shifted, if they are shifted to another area, they cannot thrive under similar conditions. They will not be able to reproduce, they will not be able to sustain as long as they are in their original habitat. So, that's why endemic species are so important, and in any ecosystem or in part of where you're studying the flora and fauna, endemic species are identified at once to realize how important is that particular region. If that the number of endemic species are negligent or not even there at all, that area cannot be considered a biodiverse area or a hotspot, because that area can be reproduced or reciprocated elsewhere as well. Certain endemic species of our country, like we have discussed the Nilgiri tar, we have the fruit, certain fruit trees, and all of these are considered also vulnerable as well as threatened species. Again, over here, when we're looking at biodiversity, you have different scales. We have decided what are the endemic species of our country. But the next stage that needs to happen is what is vulnerable, what is threatened or vulnerable, or rather which part of it is endangered or is going to is very close to extinction. So, all of these varieties of words that are being used make a huge difference of what exactly is the step that is required in the conservation of biodiversity. So, when you think of vulnerable or threatened species, these are the species whose population number is decreasing and are likely to become endangered with time if no intervention takes place. That is, if no positive steps are taken place to conserve them. The list of threatened animals have been listed in a book called the Red Data Book, or RDB. RDB was first formulated by Sir Peter Scott. The major threatened categories under IUCN are extinct, endangered, vulnerable, rare, and intermediate species. When you think of intermediate species, they are the kinds that will be there only in certain areas, but they cannot be viable in other areas. Rare and intermittent are pretty much the same. Then the vulnerable is the one that, because of certain reasons, could be natural or could be man-made, that is getting threatened or their numbers are drastically dropping. The list of few mammals which occur in India and are rated as threatened under the 2003 IUCN International Union of Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources, we will see it in the next slide. You have the Artis Asiatic Wild Ass, you have the Gaur, the Nilgiri Leaf Monkey, you have so many, we have about 18 to 15 identified species in mammals, and then you have some animals and plants which are not getting adequate attention, and one of the main reasons this is said to be is tourism. And as and when people, this becomes like a vicious circle like we have discussed even before, as and when more and more research goes into all of these forests to find the endemic species, more and more people enter these forests, and because of the number of people entering these forests, the species get a lot of negative publicity, in the sense a lot of poachers are made aware of hotspots, are made aware of biodiverse areas. And if adequate security is not given to these animals or to these hotspots, the research that is done actually proves to be detrimental. You have the Nilgiri tar, which is kind of a deer, and then the Himalayan tar, the wild goat, the gaur, the Asiatic black bear, and the Asiatic elephant. Obviously, you can see what are the reasons why these animals are hunted, right from the tusk to the skin to the horns. All of these are prime products that are received from these animals, and they are poached and hunted carelessly. Moving on to endangered species, these are the species whose numbers are critically low and their habitat is so drastically reduced that they are in the danger of extinction. At present, you have 81 species of mammal, 38 species of birds, 18 species of amphibians and reptiles, which are considered endangered species in India. Now you have the critically endangered mammals, which is the Jenkins shrew, the flying squirrel, the fruit bat, the free-tailed bat, the Malabar large spotted civet, the pygmy hog, and then you have the rhinoceros. So all of these seven are considered critically endangered mammals, and you have the international authority warning each government that, see, your list is these, as your endangered list is getting more and more, the funds that is sent over will reduce. They want to give certain incentives to help us protect our environment. But like we just saw, all of these get, all of this study, all of this research, if there is not adequate support to actually help these hotspots and these biodiverse regions, these endangered species will soon become extinct. This is the pygmy hog, large spotted civet, and the Sumatran rhinoceros. Now, what are the benefits of biodiversity? We have seen the importance of it, but you have three main benefits. Because for man to take any step to save anything, he needs to have an equation of what prosperity he's getting, what kind of positive impacts he's able to gain. Only then will any kind of funding that is related to it be considered an investment. So, biodiversity actually is known for multiple benefits. It goes beyond the simple thing of quantifying the importance of biodiversity. It is because of biodiversity that man is existing. So, if biodiversity is lost, even man will soon become extinct. So, we have economic benefits, ecological benefits, and ethical benefits. Economic benefits encompass food. All our food actually comes from plants and animals. About 80,000 plant species are potential food sources. Agriculture, the genetic diversity of wild plants are used to produce better strains of crops with superior yields. Then you have medicine, medicinal plants for Ayurveda, Yunani medicine, or even great pharmaceutical industries need synthetic drugs. Their origin is basically plants. Industries, the wood from plants is being used in industries for clothing, shelter, as fuel, as raw material for paper, rayon, plastic, for construction, etc. The modern green revolution, the farmers begin to lose their traditional systems of sustainable agriculture. However, the Bij Bachao Andolan, the BBA, has helped revive the traditional farming methods. Lesser known plants and animals of food value. There are about 10,000 varieties of cereals, but humans have concentrated only on four, namely rice, wheat, corn, and jowar. Examples we'll have in the next slide. You have medicinal plants, aloe vera, then you have different kinds of grains and other kinds of plants, which is used in cosmetics. It is actually used for different kinds of medicines to treat certain kinds of diseases like Hodgkin's disease, treatment of leukemia and types of cancer. And then you have alkaloids that are produced from these plants, which help treat schizophrenia, heart problems, and high BP. Like I just mentioned, the more and more research we do on these plants, the more and more we are actually getting them into a detrimental situation, because we realize that there is more uses to them. And as man, as greedy as he is, he wants to keep taking, and the level of replenishment that happens is very less or minimal. Ecological or social benefits. Biodiversity is important for maintenance and sustainable utilization of goods and services from ecological systems. These services include formation and protection of soil, conservation and purification of water, maintenance of hydrological cycles, etc. Forest vegetation provides natural protection to soil as soil binders that prevent soil erosion and also slows down water flow to downstream areas. The pores and cracks found in between soil particles act as natural filters, purifying water as it drips through the forest ecosystem. This not only helps in protection and conservation for fertile top soil, but also maintains ground water. Plants absorb water from soil or water reservoirs and add it to the air as water vapor by the process of transpiration. Animal and plants also lose water in vapor form by respiration. Water vapor formed by transpiration and respiration form clouds, enter the global water cycle or hydrological cycle. Next, you have soil microbes or decomposers, and soil animals like earthworms help in efficient breakdown of organic matter into inorganic nutrients, thus enriching the soil fertility. Ethical, cultural, spiritual, and religious belief system. Throughout human history, people have always related to the very existence of human race to biodiversity. Let it be through cultural, spiritual, or even religious beliefs. Many plants, animals, forests, landscapes, and rivers are considered as sacred and worshipped by people. Today, there have been many cultural heritage, and these beliefs have played an effective role in conservation of many species of plants and animals, especially preservation of many endemic and rare species. If you look at sacred species, traditionally conserved plant and animal species of religious and cultural importance, tulsi, neem, the Ashoka tree, the peepal tree, animals like cow, monkeys, cobras, etc. So, all of these have a level of religious spiritual context which helps people save these particularly. Sacred groves, it's a small patch of land with natural fauna and flora protected by local community in dedication of their deities of their ancestral spirits. These groves can range from few trees to large forest areas like the Devarakadu and the Bhutasthanas. These sthanas are basically where flowers and fruits are grown for giving to God for religious purposes. So, all of these are storehouses of many rare and endemic species. Then you have the sacred landscapes. It's a large heterogeneous area that contains a variety of natural and traditionally managed ecosystems. For example, the river Ganga is considered as a holy river. The stretch of Ganga between Haridwar and Rishikesh is conserved as Machial, where fishing is actually banned. In Karnataka, important sacred landscapes include Kudachadri Hills in the western Ghats of Kollur, Biar Hills around the temple, and the Baba Bundarigi Hills. This is the Kudachadri Hills. This is the area of Machial where no fishing is permitted. You can see the fish thriving in the water. This is the Baba Bundagiri Hills. Again, waterfalls, the greenery, nothing is tampered with. So, when a religious connotation is attached to it, people are scared to do anything to damage it. Biodiversity and balance of nature. We saw tropic levels. Elimination of species from tropic level can cause destruction of ecosystem as well as biodiversity. Complex ecosystem. In a complicated ecosystem having several tropic levels, loss of one or more species does not cause any serious problems because alternatives are definitely available. Certain keystone species. Loss or addition of species can cause detectable changes in the ecosystem, that is, species that make unique contribution to the functioning of the ecosystem. Then you have niche complementary, difference among species in their requirements for different resources will cause complementary interactions so that a species could obtain more resources. Facilitation and mutualism, plants may also benefit from their neighbors through amelioration of the physical and biotic environment. Portfolio effect. This is where species richness increases the temporal stability of the entire community while the biomass is stabilized. Insurance hypothesis. This is where biodiversity buffers the ecosystem against environmental changes such as global warming. The different benefits of biodiversity. The consumptive value, like we have seen, food, drink, fuel, medicine, better crop varieties, industrial material. Non-consumptive value you have is recreation, education and research, traditional value. Ecological services, it actually helps in maintaining balance of nature, biological productivity, regulation of climate, degradation of waste, cleaning of air and water, cycling of nutrients, control of potential pest and disease causing species, detoxification of soil and sediments, stabilization of land against erosion, carbon sequestration and global climate change, maintenance of soil fertility. Pollution, hunting, global warming and climate change, agriculture domino effect. At the end of this lecture, we have looked into biodiversity, the different types of hotspots across the globe and especially in our country, endangered species, and the importance of biodiversity. At the end of this lecture, we should be able to answer the following questions. What is biodiversity? Discuss the concept and types of biodiversity. Discuss any two biodiversity hotspots in India. What are the benefits of biodiversity? Discuss the balance of nature the biodiversity brings. That brings us to the end of this lecture. Thank you.